Hi friends, welcome to the third part of this presentation. In previous presentation, we described cellular basis of COVID, that is Clara cell and pneumocyte type 2. These two cells are primarily implicated in this particular disease. When we discuss pathogenesis, any theory or any explanation must be parallel with two things. One is autopsy findings, and second is clinical observation. So today we discuss how this C-type and P-type COVID goes exactly parallel with what we see in autopsy as well as what we see in clinical management of COVID. So let us discuss first about C-type. When we're discussing these types, first we'll have a hypothetical figures of two alveoli, one normal alveolus, one abnormal alveolus, and what happens in each type of corona. So let us see this figure. Both these alveoli, hypothetical, there are hypothetical airway compartments and hypothetical alveolar compartments. In this junction of bronchioles and alveolus, that is BAD, bronchiolo-alveolar duct junction, the Clara cell is situated. In this Clara cell is quite normal functioning cell. What are the functions of Clara cells? There are many functions, but for our interest, two functions are important. First function is, it is anti-inflammatory role. So this Clara cell tries to dampen the unnecessary inflammatory reaction. So if naturally, if Clara cell is dysfunction, then this inflammatory markers, they go up. This has been beautifully seen in many experiments, the inverse relationship with mast cell activity. If Clara cells are less, mast cell activity goes up. So Clara cells are very central in managing the pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory balance. Clara cell goes down, anti-inflammatory goes down, pro-inflammatory goes up. So this Clara cell is located at crucial juncture, and this is acting in tandem with one more colleague, that is pneumocyte type 2. Now this pneumocyte type 2 releases, secretes surfactant. This surfactant is very important to keep the alveolus open, but it is very unstable. The stability is provided by surfactant proteins. But these surfactant proteins are liberated by this Clara cell. So it liberates surfactant proteins, they interact with surfactant, and the alveolus remains open. Surface tension reducing property of surfactant is well known. So what happens when something goes wrong? So here we have got a normal alveolus, functioning Clara cell, functioning pneumocyte. This Clara cell is producing surfactant protein, pneumocyte is producing also surfactant protein and surfactant. It is stable surfactant, it is lining the walls of alveoli, and alveoli are kept open. During expiration, alveoli are not collapsing. Now in COVID, what is happening? This is happening. In this COVID, what happens is that this Clara cell is now dysfunctional. Now once Clara cell dysfunction sets in, surfactant proteins suffer, surfactant activity suffers, surfactant becomes very unstable. And during expiration especially, when these two walls of alveoli come together, then they collapse. Now this collapse of alveoli is a central feature of COVID, because that only explains the ground glass opacity, which is seen in periphery. This collapse of alveoli is also seen in postmortem reports. This particular thing is very straightforward. What is not that straightforward is last word, that is hypoxic local vasoconstriction. Now we have to understand this hypoxic local vasoconstriction in detail, because COVID patients, some patients present with distress, no hypoxia. Some patient present with hypoxia and no distress. Now this particular peculiar patient is going to present with distress but no hypoxia. Why hypoxia does not happen in this particular group? Hypoxia does not happen. If you see only saturation, we'll think that saturation is good, will be reassuring. But no, this particular baby, the patient can be having actually ongoing COVID. So how hypoxia is prevented here? If you see the bottom part of figure, this is the pulmonary vessel supplying this particular hypothetical alveolus. It is carrying deoxygenated blood and getting oxygen from alveolus and going again back to heart. Suppose the alveolar PO2 comes down. This alveolar PO2 comes down. This low alveolar PO2 in this alveolus is actually affecting interstitial PO2. Interstitial PO2 comes down. That is sensed by mitochondria in smooth muscles in wall of the vessel. Now, once they sense this hypoxia, potassium channels are blocked. Calcium channels are opened. Calcium enters the smooth muscle cell and that leads to contraction. So this vasoconstriction is very, very important defense mechanism against this hypoxia. Why? Because once vasoconstriction develops here, the blood supply to the useless alveolus is reduced. And this blood supply is diverted to nearby good alveolus. Means, in short, in easy terms, the useful alveoli and useless alveoli are present all over the lungs. This is the mechanism by which unnecessary wastage of perfusion is prevented and blood supply is diverted from this alveolus with less ventilation to alveolus with more ventilation. This hypoxic local vasoconstriction is explanation for majority of lung diseases. Saturations are actually pretty normal. So, but remember this very important is COVID, one subtype of COVID presentation is there where distress is more but saturation is maintained. So this blood supply will be reduced, this blood supply will be increased and sum total net will get adequate oxygenation. This is a defense mechanism. So this is defense mechanism is operative in C type of COVID. Why it is operative? Because there is no change in alveolar permeability. We'll see afterwards. Now how this peculiar pathogenesis explains the clinical picture. Now here, oxygen saturation is normal. Carbon dioxide is increased. This carbon dioxide leads to stimulation of breathing. Respiratory rate increases. Distress appears. Headache comes up and confusion may happen in some patients. Some patients may be tired and confused. They typically describe it is different from myalgia. Myalgia is pain and tiredness and confusion is different. So when they coming out of myalgia, they start developing extreme tiredness and confusion. This can be explained based on carbon dioxide buildup. So this is a C type where hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction is operating, saturation is maintained, but patient is slowly developing progressive distress. Now many cases are asymptomatic, but show ground glass opacities on CT scan. Because even if some part of lung is affected, remaining part is doing extremely good job and blood supply is being diverted from useless part to useful part. So everything appears to be fine. Patients are asymptomatic. They are only having distress on exertion, heart rate going up after exertion, respiratory rate going up after exertion. But predominantly, they are predominantly asymptomatic. Ongoing collapse of alveoli in some cases spreads bilaterally, radially, and distress keeps on increasing. Distress and tachypnea responds to HFNC. This has got a lot of importance for management perspective. HFNC, how it works? High flow nasal cannula. High flow nasal cannula, once you put in nose, then the interphase of gas exchange, rather than alveolus, it happens in upper airways itself. The old gas, which is rich in CO2, is replaced by a fresh gas, which is rich in O2. So this old gas and fresh gas keep on interacting with each other. So need for ventilation automatically comes down. Tachypnea comes down, distress comes down, and need for ventilation is postponed or sometimes prevented also. Don't forget the first function of Clara cell. That was anti-inflammatory. Now Clara cell is not functioning well. Fever is rising, inflammation is rising, and this fever and inflammation typically responds to anti-inflammatories like steroids or immunomodulators. These work excellently in this particular subgroup because it is related with inflammation. Rarely need ventilation. These patients rarely need ventilation. If at all ventilation is required, it is because of worsening distress. Oxygen may go down in late stages. Worsening distress, rising CO2 is the reason. And they require sufficient settings. And once you ventilate the patient, then they start recovering. Not all, some of them. Now let us go to the next part. This P-type COVID. Now, here we can see again two normal alveoli. Here there are two Clara cells. Here there are two pneumocyte type 2. Now, functions of pneumocyte type 2. Now, we are in P type, that is pneumocyte type. What are the functions of pneumocyte type 2? Mainly produces surfactant, which keeps alveolus open. This is a well-known fact in preterm babies with RDS, that when pneumocyte type 2 is not functioning well, then they go for collapse of alveolus. Next function here is maintaining integrity of alveolar membrane. What is that? That is integrity of alveolar membrane. This alveolar membrane is very thin. It's surrounded by a very flat, thin layer of pneumocyte type 1. Now, this pneumocyte type 2 is important in maintaining integrity. If pneumocyte type 2 is not functioning well, the integrity will be lost. Means inside things will come out, outside things will go inside. And both these things are important for this P-type COVID. Let us see. Now, what is happening here? Clara cell is functioning very well. Pneumocyte 2 is not functioning very well. Pneumocyte 2 has become dysfunctional. Integrity is compromised. Outside things are coming inside. Now, outside things are coming. What are the outside things? Water. Water in interstitium is rapidly coming inside. What are the outside? Inflammatory cells, macrophages. They are waiting for this. Macrophages start going inside. So now this alveolus will be full, partially or completely by water and cells. Cells means inflammatory cells. Now this water and cell will actually lead to some amount of gasless situation. The alveoli become partly gasless. They collapse. But here collapse is partial, not complete like seated. We'll come to know about that. So here we are dealing with pneumocyte type 2 dysfunction, compromised integrity, water and cell is coming inside, and alveoli collapsing partially. Now here there is a fundamental difference. The key difference between P type and cell type is happening here. Local vasoplasia. This is a beautiful term coined by Italian intensivist Gattoneni. Local vasoplasia. What is this local vasoplasia? We are knowing about paraplasia, monoplasia, paralysis. Unable to function. Unable to contract. Unable to constrict. So this is the local vasoplasia. I mean, previous we saw that there is hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction in C-type, which is normal defense mechanism. But this mechanism does not operate here. Even if the alveolar PO2 is low, there is no local vasoconstriction. This caliber and this caliber is same. So blood keeps on going to useless alveoli. This is paralysis of defense mechanism. That's why you call local vasoplasia, paralysis of vessel. This is will be a recurring theme in further presentations. Local vasoplasia. Now this local vasoplasia is something which is, we have to explain why it happens only in P, not in C. Why it happens? No local vasoplasia, no local vasoconstriction, because in this situation, these outside cells and water is coming inside. Here these inflammatory cells produce something which is called as leukotrienes. So these leukotrienes, they inhibit constriction and they allow vasodilation. Actually, because of hypoxia, local hypoxia, this vessel should have been constricted. It does not happen because the leukotrienes are trying to keep it open. Now, this is bad news because what is happening is blood is coming to the useless alveolus. Now, this is called as intrapulmonary shunt. Shunt means this particular blood, which is actually should be oxygenated, is not being oxygenated. It is coming directly to heart again. Now, this particular intrapulmonary shunt is the key feature in majority of this P type of COVID. Now, what will happen clinically? We'll see. Now, last time we saw in CC cell, there is complete collapse. Here, there is partial collapse. This is proven by autopsy findings. In many cases, they saw pneumocyte to hyperplasia actually. Not actually hypoplasia, hyperplasia. By hyperplasia, we remember that Clara cell can transdifferentiate into pneumocyte 2. Clara cell is intact. Pneumocytes are actually being affected, but it is responded by Clara cell being actually transdifferentiating into pneumocyte type 2, preventing complete collapse. So, typical finding here will be alveolar desquamation in autopsy. Leukocyte 2 hyperplasia will be there. Inflammation will be there. Edema will be there. And there is no local vasoconstriction. In fact, it has been observed in those patients who are in ICU for a long time. They develop a lot of interceptive angiogenesis. So it correlates well with autopsy findings also. Let us see what happens clinically. Now, this is most important part. All of us have to understand that distress is absent in initial stages. Distress is absent. But hypoxia is early. Why hypoxia is early? Because intrapulmonary shunts are there. Why intrapulmonary shunts are there? There is no hypoxic local vasoconstriction is there. Why it is not there? Because of leukotrienes. Leukotrienes, why they are there? Because of a lot of cells are inside the alveolus which are producing leukotrienes. So this early hypoxia and no distress, this peculiar particular combination delays the diagnosis. Patient is not distressed, he is only hypoxic, and there is no saturation monitoring. He spends long time in quarantine centers at homes. And patient is pretty comfortable actually. Respiratory rate is near normal or only slightly increased because there is no complete collapse of alveolus, partial collapse of alveolus. Some pneumocytes are functioning. No confusion, intact sensoria. Carbon dioxide near normal. Saturation low early in course and progressive. The saturation is low and keeps on dropping as the disease improves. Even if you give oxygen, it does not respond fully to oxygen. Because here the basic reason is lack of hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction and intrapulmonary shunting. It is behaving like in other ways congenital aortic heart disease. Even if you give oxygen, it rises a little bit but doesn't become normal. So comfortable patient, no distress, no tachypnea, hypoxia early, responding poorly to administered oxygen. This is a hallmark of this PTE. Now, what are the implications of this? All we discussed, the C-type and P-type, does it make any difference in actual management of patient? Yes, it has got large implications for community level also. Previously, we were going by syndromic approach to this COVID. Means our healthcare workers will visit the hospital, healthcare workers will visit home, they will take interview of the patient, we'll keep on asking, are you having cough, cold, myalgia, headache, confusion and all those things. Majority of people will say that I'm not having anything. I had fever previously, I had myalgia, but at present I'm absolutely fine. So one group of patients will have distress, one group of patients won't have distress. Those who are having hypoxia won't have distress, those who are having distress won't have hypoxia. Because one is having C-type, one is having P-type. So symptoms of distress are less reliable than objective signs. So WHO has come out with objective signs to be given more importance than symptoms. Now, what are the objective signs? Respiratory rate and saturation monitoring, both should be mandatory. Some states, in fact, they have encouraged home oxygen monitoring. Those are positive patients who are in quarantine centers or admitted. Their daily saturation monitoring is must because they may not have distress, only hypoxia. So this respiratory rate and saturation monitoring are complementary to each other. We can't compare or we can't have one among them. So I repeat, signs more important than symptoms. Symptoms can be deceptive. Respiratory rate and saturation monitoring, both are important because both will give different clues to different types. Respiratory rate, more than 20, it is going for early C-type. Saturation, 92 or less, it is giving early indication of early P-type. Saturation monitoring must be considered essential in each case. So don't wait for patient to become distressed and then coming to you and then saying patient came late. No. Saturation monitoring and respiratory rate both should be done in all cases of proven or suspected COVID. So today we discussed about pathogenesis of grossly P-type and C-type. So it is just a foundation. What we learned today is hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction, local vasoconstriction, which prevents unnecessary wastage of perfusion to useless alveolus is present in one, absent in one. That gives you two populations. One population with early distress but saturation good. Second population with no distress but saturation low. And both these populations should be given equal importance. This is the main carry home message of this today's presentation. Next presentation, we'll go for the peculiar picture of what we call as happy hypoxia syndrome. So thanks a lot for watching this video. I've been looking forward for next presentation, short presentation about happy hypoxia syndrome and how to go about in preventing worsening of these patients after apparent well-being. Thank you.